This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. When you sign up at curiositystream.com/royalocean, you'll also get access to Nebula, the streaming video platform that Royal Ocean is a part of. It's incredibly rare that a film stops me cold with only its log line.
Tatara Kimiko-san, つまり anata desu ga, kino o nakunari ni narimashita. Domo. Goshoushousama desu.
All of these people have just recently passed away, and it's now their responsibility to choose from the whole of their lives one single memory to spend the rest of eternity with.
印象に残った大切な思い出を一つだけ選んでいただきたいんですが。
When they've made their choice, their memory is then recreated on a soundstage and put to film for them to see. And after watching the recreation, each person moves on, carrying with them only that memory and nothing else. What memory would you live with forever? That's the question presented to the recently deceased in Hirokazu Koreeda's 1998 film, Afterlife. The kind of film that I find myself thinking about at odd times and on quiet days. It's obviously such a difficult but inherently compelling question that you could spend hours and days thinking about. This from a director whose filmography, perhaps more than any other of our day, is laced with the kind of melancholy that memory can bring. Memories and their effect over time is something often at the heart of Koreeda's films. Many are stories set in the aftermath of traumatic events and follow characters who are haunted by memories of the past. But in all of his films, it's the deeply powerful value of memories that resonates in the end. For what are we really without memories? What I think is so interesting about the memories that characters select in Afterlife is just how small they seem. Very few choose what we would normally think of as big, exciting events. On the contrary, most of them are these tiny little interstitial moments from their lives, minute details and feelings. As counterintuitive as it may seem, it's memories of utterly mundane things and events that are now, through time and perspective, completely saturated with importance. And I think a lot of the reason why that is because memories by nature are likely based far less in facts and far more in interpretation. That's how and why a mundane event which means very little can end up meaning so much. Memories change. Sometimes we remember things that didn't actually happen. Does the man who chooses a memory from when he was only 6 months old actually remember what he says he does? Memories evolve, they mutate, and they can take on new meaning. When he enters the afterlife, the elderly Watanabe struggles to find a memory worth living with from a life he calls only just average and unremarkable. To assist his decision, he's given surveillance-like tapes from the whole of his life. And it's only through this that a previously insignificant moment with his wife suddenly becomes the thing he wishes to live with forever. There's been a lot written about the relationship between cinema and memory. The two share this intricate, intimate link. And yet I don't think anyone or any film has come as close to encapsulating or even transcending that idea as Koreeda does with Afterlife. Stay with me now. We've talked about how memories change and evolve over time. In that respect, a memory is not reality. It's something separate. It's an interpretation of reality, an abstraction of reality. Now, let's switch gears just slightly. What are stories, if not the exact same thing? A fictional made-up story isn't reality. It didn't happen. It's a good lie, in a sense. And it's just as much of an abstraction of reality as a memory is. And in the exact same way that we do with memories, we hold on to stories as these beloved treasures without which we're lost. I mean, what are we really without stories? They're how we communicate, they guide, they instruct, they comfort, they're how we make sense of things. Now, stay with me one step further. What's the link between stories and memory, but cinema? When you revisit a memory, isn't it almost like playing a movie inside your head? And if that's true, then isn't watching a film almost like watching a memory? Memories are partial, the academic David Desser describes. Fragmentary, made up of moments, sensations, dim recollections. And movies, too, we may infer, have much to offer in forming such memories through images that are themselves necessarily fragments. That is, I'd argue, the idea that's running through the heart of Koreeda's film, which beautifully marries cinema and memory together in an altogether profound way. You could even say that Afterlife has a sense of memory baked into its very DNA, harkening back to Yasujirō Ozu with its precise framing, Kurosawa's Akira, which just so happens to also feature the story of a man named Watanabe finding meaning in a self-proclaimed average and unremarkable life. And of course, with Frank Capra's It's a Wonderful Life.
Well, come on, Gabriel.
Clarence!
Also about a heavenly guide helping to steer a lost soul towards a deeper appreciation of the life they were given. But in Afterlife, the key character is not the lost soul, but the guide, the attendant Mochizuki. When we meet him, he's been dead for nearly 50 years, but unable to move on. Like the other attendants, he was unable to choose a memory to live with, and is thus now tasked, or doomed, with the responsibility of helping others who pass through the way station. It's he who helps Watanabe reassess his average life. But this proves to be the turning point in his own journey. Watanabe's wife, as fate would have it, was Mochizuki's fiancé before his own untimely death. Perhaps he doesn't want to move on because he feels robbed of the happiness he deserved. Regardless, in helping Watanabe, he discovers both that the marriage that did occur was indeed a happy one, and that his fiancée never forgot him, choosing a memory of him as her own to live with forever. For Mochizuki, this results in a profound realization and later the choice of his own memory to be filmed. And what is it? It's the memory of the moment he realized the deep value of his work, of helping others along the path to come to grips with their own lives, and by extension, the value of the role that cinema plays in that effort. The role that memory plays in our lives is one of those fascinating things you could spend forever thinking about. And if you're interested in learning more, I'd highly, highly recommend checking out this video's sponsor, CuriosityStream. They have thousands of documentaries and nonfiction titles on a whole variety of subjects. If you enjoyed this video, check out the episode Tricky Memory that goes into incredible depth on the question of just how reliable our memories really are. You can watch that and so much more, and when you sign up at curiositystream.com/royalocean and use the code royalocean, you'll not only get your first 31 days completely free, but as an added bonus, your CuriosityStream subscription now comes with a free Nebula subscription. Nebula is a new streaming service built by and for creators, including a ton of my absolute favorite film essay channels. Lessons from the Screenplay, Just Right, Patrick Willems, Lindsay Ellis. It's a place for us to try new things and create content that just wouldn't be possible on YouTube. Give CuriosityStream a shot and get free access to Nebula when you sign up at curiositystream.com/royalocean.